Good afternoon. Welcome to our session. We had some technical issues, so that's the reason why we started a little bit later. We're going to talk today about Microsoft Advanced Threat Protection. I'm doing that together with Eric. He will introduce himself in a moment. The whole idea is if you implemented Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection, anyone already using it? Okay, now, well, we want to make you aware of some things, and this session will go into more detail about that. For the agenda, we are going a bit into the history of where it comes from. We have a long history with Microsoft antivirus and some experience. Microsoft Threat Protection as a solution in a whole. And then we go into a little bit more depth on Microsoft Defender ATP. That's what this session is about. And we prepared some demos, actually a lot of them. So I hope we can make it within the 45 minutes time frame we have today. And if not, yeah, we'll see. So it's Friday, so fun day. Eric, you can get your mic now, and then I will continue. My name is Kenneth van Zurksen. I'm a managing consultant at Insight24. Besides my work as a modern workplace specialist, I actually do a lot of community activities. Together with Eric, we are in the WMUG. We also help organize Experts Live in the Netherlands as a community event. So, well, for the rest, enough about me. Let's continue. The thing we are going to talk about today has to do with cybersecurity. Microsoft is not really known as a security company, but nowadays it actually is a security company. And this picture gives us an idea of all the security products Microsoft currently has. And it might be that the picture is not up to date anymore because new products are being added like weekly or maybe monthly. So this is, but to give you an idea of what's possible with security nowadays, this picture will tell the whole story.
Yeah, we'll go back one slide. This we're only going to discuss advanced threat protection. This is one piece of the complete cyber security reference architecture for Microsoft. Yeah. So there's much more to tell, but we only take one block of the whole security area.
But before we continue, let's go into the portal and give you an idea of what we are talking about. Let me skip this one and then duplicate the screen. It's already duplicated, as I can see. If everything is okay, you can see the screen now. Is there anybody who didn't see the Microsoft Defender Security Center yet? One of the issues Microsoft currently has is that they have a lot of portals, too many portals, and you can get lost in which portal you need for what functionality. This is the Microsoft Defender Security Center, securitycenter.microsoft.com. Doesn't make any sense, but that's the portal you actually need. And if you go to the Security Center, you're presented with, of course, cool dashboards. Because cool dashboards, they present nice on big screens, etc. We have a tenant here in which Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection is actually implemented, and that gives us some data. The data in this case is actually represented in incidents. So these are actually machines which have something or reported something which concerns Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection. Let me check back here. So we should have, some some resolution stuff going on here. One moment, I need to scroll. And then we have like the a machine over here, which we will use now for our example. if we have a machine which has an incident, we can actually zoom into that machine. Sorry about the screen resolution. I need to do some stuff here. Let me check.
The resolution was higher, but the beamer is flickering, so we moved up a little bit.
Yeah, but that this resolution is not really helping because I'm lost. Okay. What we see here on this machine actually is we have some incidents being reported by Microsoft Defender ATP, and from the portal we can actually zoom in on what's going on. And while we were preparing the demo for this machine, we actually saw that a new new malware was actually detected for this machine. And what we actually can do, we can actually zoom in on that malware and we actually get an idea of what happened. And as you can see here, this subject actually received an email which had a document in it which actually had an had a Trojan inserted into it. And that's something that actually is being detected by Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection, but it wasn't detected by the Defender software, which actually was the antivirus software on the machine at that point in time. Yeah. So, well, what happened? It did something with Chrome, Acrobat Reader, and if you have these kinds of incidents, you can actually zoom in all the way to what happened with, in this case, the Trojan within the network. Is that something we can see in Defender Advanced Threat Protection as well at the moment? Do we have it? Okay, let me check. Too bad from the... I'm going to skip that part.
Open all notifications, you can try. Clear. Oh, sorry.
Expand. Alle instellingen. And then we have the security parts, Windows Beveiliging. We don't see that anymore, I think. This is in Dutch, but as you can see, actually now it's actually being detected by Microsoft Defender as well. And that could actually mean that if somebody else has the same problem, it's now being detected by the antivirus software or by the anti-malware software, while in the beginning it was not detected and it was detected by Advanced Threat Protection. So we will go into more detail about how that whole loop works. But the main idea is that actually Advanced Threat Protection goes further than your antivirus software or your anti-malware protection software. Let's go back to the presentation. Even let me check if that works. Seems okay. Okay. So that was a short introduction about the portal being used. And when going back to this screen, there are lots of portals for all that functionality. And I do believe that in the near future, maybe Microsoft will come with one portal, or at least like an overview portal with links to all the other portals. But until that time, you have to use other measurements or other tools to actually visualize your whole security posture.
The next, also a big problem with the portal nowadays, is it comes from other portals, but there's also a new feature or a new service, Azure Sentinel, which also marks of moving stuff from the Azure Security Center to Sentinel, and nobody really knows what it's going to look like. So this year, and maybe the beginning of the next year, it will be a struggle in which version, which setting you can find. So the portal is a continuous moving on and missing parts.
But every time we open the portal, we see new functionality or functionality being moved from the left to the right or whatever they come up with. Hey, to go back to the beginning of antivirus, both Eric and I, we have some experience with IT already. And I started in IT before the year 2000, I believe Eric as well. But we started in a time where we didn't have any antivirus software on the machines. Perhaps some other people also still know that time. But Microsoft in 2004 actually recognized, well, maybe we need to do something with antivirus. And they actually, they bought a company called Giant Software. And that company actually had an antivirus product. And maybe if you look at the screenshot here, then maybe you still recognize the first product, which was called Microsoft Anti-Spyware. Now, many people had that running. Windows Defender was running on Windows XP. And actually, Microsoft still uses the same name, but don't mistake that with the same technology, because it's not the same. So the technology is more and more advanced nowadays. But these screens are actually bringing a little bit of nostalgia to our minds. So looking at the Microsoft Defender ATP, Microsoft actually from Windows 8, they actually started investing more and more in how should we call it? It's more like does everybody know what heuristic scanning is? So we had actually the antivirus definitions, but the heuristic scanning was more behavior based. Well, actually, MD-ATP is like heuristic scanning, but then more on steroids, because we actually use cloud technology to actually use swarm detection from many endpoints to tell us about if something is going on. But actually, that was really finished when Windows 10 came out, with the endpoint detection and response solution provided out of the box. So, we are now a full creators update, is also a while ago, but with every Windows 10 release, new and new features are actually are added to the solution. That's something we can demo as well, Erik?
Yes. First, we want to demo, investigate the security incident. Also, what are your options? And there are some two new features added to Microsoft Defender ATP that you can also have a callback to your system. Let's go back to the first version of ATP. ATP is based on log analytics. If you don't know log analytics, it sends the information from your laptop and servers, if you want, to Microsoft Azure. So the first thing you need to know about ATP, you have to set up telemetry. There's much to do about it. Microsoft is looking on your system. If you don't set up telemetry, you cannot use ATP. The next thing, because Microsoft ATP is looking after the upload to the logs, it's always lagging 15, 20, 30 minutes late. Dus in the first versions, it only discovers behavior, what kind of things. It's also, for example, what Kenneth just showed, the exe file from the email. The end user didn't see anything about it because it was 20 minutes later Microsoft ATP discovered it. So also for demo purposes, if you do something, you never see it in the demo because then it's the end of the session. So you also have to prepare it. But there are two new things I want to see. So why do I want to show that? Because that's the way Microsoft is moving on. Now you can isolate machines from the system, which is a new feature released this summer. And you can also re-release and you can also have some kind of back channel to your system. That two features I want to show. It's not completed yet. It's it's usable, but it's not version 1, let's say. But it's the way Microsoft is going to. So that's really important to know. So let's take this this laptop we are demoing is also the laptop we're going to isolate. Let's go.
Should I keep my fingers crossed for the demo? Or?
No. No. We're going to isolate. I have a ping to Google, you all know. We also can do to the internal network, but this internal network, the gateway sends already destination, that kind of thing. So it's not cool to demo. Let's see. Then you have the resolution is not that really nice. Here you have. initiate live response, and you have here isolate machine. So I have this machine, which is this laptop, and I have a thread, and I say block all the network. So I'm gonna click isolate machine. Then you get, okay, you can isolate it, but do you want to open a connection to Outlook Teams so you can have a chat? For example, that person is working at home. That's the idea of Microsoft, you can work everywhere. So you can have communication with the end user, what you as a system administrator are doing. So, of course, we want to block this block all, confirm. And look what happens immediately. But that's not, a week ago we did the presentation, it lagged 2 minutes. This now it's directly, but it's not always direct. I don't know why, but other strange thing which I discovered, Google, the Microsoft site, nu.nl just still works, but our machine is blocked. But cisco.com, a week ago, works. What is my ip.com? It's blocked. So that's a question I have to Microsoft. I don't know the answer, but why do you block what is my ip.com and you don't block cisco.com and the Dutch version, what is my ip.nl? Tell me what's the use case. But this, the internal network is blocked completely and parts of the internet are also blocked. But why the parts? It is not really clear to me. I've asked Microsoft, I didn't get a response I can do something with. But this is interesting. So you can, if you have an incident, you can remotely block that laptop from the network instead of walking to it and pull out the plug. So prevent issues. But as I said, it's version one. Maybe it's that case that it is not.
So it should probably say partially isolate in that case.
Yeah, but also I can also open it again. Release from isolation. And I'm back. And also can go to the, I think to this site now. Check. So that's the idea of isolation. Then you have also a new feature is initiate live response. It's a little bit hidden. If you want to test it for yourself, you go to settings, you go to advanced features, and then you have to enable live response here. Otherwise, you don't have that feature. Why do you have to enable this? This support setting, because the live response you get an unattended access to the machine. So if I'm going to access the machine, you don't get a pop-up, and that can be a problem. For example, for banking, or we have some customers who do many things with credit cards. If you can look, there's also when you can look at the screen, you know the credit card number. So normally when you do a takeover, for example, with TeamViewer to help the customer as a service desk, you have to verify, okay, I move out all the credit card numbers, you can now take a look at my computer. But with this, you get in the computer, nobody sees it. So that's also, I think, a thing Microsoft has to fix before you can implement it, because banking needs security. But for my opinion, it's not really ready for all those bank sites because of this. So let's do this. Let's go to that computer. And initiate live response session. Yeah, here it is. It's gonna set it. Now, I do there, but it is not a command shell. So there are, you have a subset of commands. I have a URL. You can see what are your options. You can upload and download files. For example, if you want to the quarantined file, you want to check for yourself, or upload it to Microsoft. It's also new, one of the features. You can look at processes. You have a subset of commands, but it is if I type after this, I will do the who am I or that kind of DOS commands. They are not accessible in this session. Yeah, and this is the one investigation I am running as a system, so I can do anything on the system. There's also everything I do is logged, so that is just they are working on the thing I want to mention. You can see my connect, my dir, my process, but who am I? The not working command is not there, so that gives also possibilities. So disconnect the session. So another new feature is you have to add an additional service, or maybe it's for third parties, for third party socks. But if you have an issue, you can also say I want to consult Microsoft. And then you can have a service from them. So if you have really big problem, you also call Microsoft. This also was beginning of this year, they announced the Microsoft security team. And you have different options like restrict app execution. You can run the antivirus, but normally if you have an issue, you want to quarantine the machine, and maybe you want to consult Microsoft, or you can do it yourself. So that was about this demo. It's about the log files, it's investigating log files, and now Microsoft is moving on to make to also get a real-time callback to the machine. This is the first version, not really usable yet, but it's getting better, of course. Also, one thing we didn't show is the session name is Sit Back and Relax Now after ATP. So there are three things you have to do after ATP. One thing is you have to follow up the alert. That's what we're showing here. The second thing is there's also a secure score in the ATP. So you get recommendations how to fix my security on the machine. But also when you have new Windows 10 versions, then you also get new features to better secure your system. So the secure score thing and always keeping up to date is the next duty you have after setting up ATP. So ATP only, and no incident, no follow-up of the incidents, and no follow-up on the secure score. Yeah, why do you install ATP at all? So that's the two things. And the third thing is what we're going to show after, but first Kenneth will continue with the presentation.
Yeah, but actually we see nowadays where in our user groups, people already comparing their secure scores against each other. And if you look in the portal as well, you actually see also your secure score actually compared to other companies within the same industry. And you would be amazed how low that score is.
We it's also checked our secure scores
yeah,
together.
Yeah, but Eric won. Okay. Hey. Looking at the overall picture, the Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection is actually part of what Microsoft calls Microsoft Threat Protection. So there are more solutions actually using that. And that's all being based on what we know as the Microsoft Intelligent Security Graph. To explain it a little bit more simple, Microsoft has actually a large database where all kinds of signals from different products actually come in, and there are some kind of intelligence runs which actually makes sense of that. But the main advantage is actually that data which comes out of that is actually being shared again. For example, that document which had like a Trojan in it, it's also being told to Office 365 ATP, which will block that attachment from now on, once detected. So if you have Office 365 ATP as part of your E5 license, for example, that will also leverage that same functionality. And by doing this, they actually created like a sort of loop where everything that's being detected is actually being processed by all the other products as well, which makes Microsoft actually quite good in the latest antivirus scans because of that. So they have a large machine learning and maybe and also some artificial intelligence. What I call it, it was heuristic scanning on steroids being used. And because they have a large installed base, they actually have good detection rates at the moment. The products which actually make use of it are being displayed in the following slides. Maybe you have some of those products, maybe you have all of them. But if you have all of them and you use the ATP functionality, they actually work together to give you an overall security post. Yeah? And based on that, Microsoft is actually quite is scoring quite good in the magic quadrants being published by Gartner nowadays. And we're not saying that the Gartner magic quadrants are always right, but I do think that Microsoft is actually doing quite well nowadays. And by companies like Forrester, Microsoft is also being recommended as a security company nowadays. And that used to be different. And many companies are still using non-Microsoft antivirus or anti-malware solutions nowadays. But actually, the Microsoft products are actually doing a good job nowadays and actually score really high in the antivirus tests which take place every month. Zooming in on Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protections, that is actually advanced threat protection for endpoints. And for most companies, those endpoints are Windows 10 based, but we can also have integration with other platforms. I will go into more detail in a slide after this. In order to use it, you actually need E5 licensing. So for the people who already have it, you probably have an E5 license as well. But this is actually the reason for Microsoft to sell E5 to companies which have E3 licenses now, today. So you need to go to E5 licenses. You can buy an add-on on E3, giving you only the advanced threat protection part, though. So that's a special add-on which you can buy. You don't have to go to the Microsoft 365 E5, which gives you all, but you can have some separate modules as well, which can save you a little bit of money. We do see more and more companies actually buying the Microsoft 365 E5 license today, so which gives you the whole package. The supported platforms, which is interesting as well, they still support Windows 7 SP1. I think within 3-4 months, Windows 7 is not supported anymore. We have some extended support available, but advanced threat protection can run on Windows 7 SP1. And the same goes for Windows Server 2008 R2. We still have a lot of companies using it. Maybe within your company as well. And the reasons for using it are obvious, because you can't migrate software or some other things. But we will go into a little bit more detail about the risks you are taking by running an old software release. There's something available for macOS. That's the reason why recently Microsoft renamed Windows Defender Advanced Threat Protection to Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection. So it's multi-platform now. And they actually provide, by use of third-party software, integration with Linux, Android, and other software as well. So looking at the installed base within companies, you can actually use Defender Advanced Threat Protection for all the platforms in use. The main difference between antivirus software, anti-malware software, and advanced threat protection is actually the fact that advanced threat protection assumes breach. So the whole idea is that this product comes into play assuming that attackers are already within your network or on your devices by sending an attachment with something in it, or they actually find another way to actually break into your system. And that is actually where Microsoft Defender Advanced Threat Protection actually comes in. So it assumes breach, that something is going on in your network. Well, within Microsoft Defender ATP, we have all kinds of functionality in order to investigate, to reduce the attack surface, to do a reduction on that. And you can expect more and more functionality actually to come in play to with Microsoft Defender ATP. All cloud powered, so if you don't have any cloud connection, well, you might have an issue. And that actually brings us to maybe the introduction to our next demo. So if you have a product which assumes breach, and it can actually detect everything that's going on your systems, why do we even need like an antivirus product anymore? Because if it's being detected and you can do something about it, or why do we still need that? Our case, which we want to make, if we have MDATP within our network, do we still have to worry about security? Are all our problems solved? Now, we don't think so, and I think we can prove that as well, Erik, or not?
Yes, we sat down together. How can we evade Microsoft Defender ATP? So, one of the main things Microsoft Defender ATP does is uploading the logs to Microsoft. So, if Microsoft doesn't get logs, it doesn't see anything, it cannot do anything about it. So, that's what we are talking about, and then we said, "No, let's make some kind of proof of concept that when you are normally when you go here in the Supernova Wi-Fi hotspot network, you get a DNS server, you get a DHCP server, but the DNS server you go to www.nu.nl, or are you sure you're getting to nu.nl, or does it resolve to anything else?" So, also the DSP server, is that a DSP server which is hosted here, or is it a DSP server for my system which was running here on this Wi-Fi network? That's the question. Nobody knows. And that's also the case about this proof of concept, and we did some demo thing about to make it really happen. So, the case is, what if I get my laptop in a network? I first do a DHCP starvation, so I give me all the addresses you have, DHCP server. I get a tool for it, I will show it. Then the DHCP server won't serve any addresses anymore because he's full. Okay. Then start my own DHCP server. So every request gets to my DHCP server and I respond. In my response, just a normal IP address, but with a different DNS server. That DNS server, and you can look on the Microsoft site, which DNS systems ATP needs to upload these logs, then you can say, go to anything else. And then nobody sees it, and then just open your hack box and try to get in the laptop. Do as much as you can. If you are system on the network, you can also delete the logs, so nobody will ever see that you were in or you have implemented the systems. That was our proof of concept. So that's what we wanted to show from, lies in theory, but can it also be practically? We think yes. And so we did some demo thing about this to show it.
This is always like a cat and mouse game between actually the hackers and the people detecting it. So like today, where I saw an article of somebody who figured out to trick the system that Windows 10 was running in Windows PE modus, and therefore no security logs were recorded anymore on the system. So people actually trying to do stuff, they keep finding things to actually block the logging of systems, and therefore it will always be a cat and mouse game. Microsoft will probably fix it, but not directly.
Now to see how difficult it is, so everybody, you can download Kali Linux. It's also in the Windows Store, if you use the Windows Store. This is Yersinia. It's just a toolbox of all kinds of hacker tools. You can say launch attack. It's really easy. And you say sending discover packets, or creating rogue DHCP is the next step. So DDoS and no, look what happened. And within 10 seconds, we overloaded the complete DHCP server. It's that easy to do a DHCP starvation. So let's, so that's the first step. Just want to show you, it is not really a big deal to do this. And if you don't implement anything about this DHCP thing, yeah, it's working all your network also, and you can try it. So let's skip this part. So now the DHCP, I can start my own DHCP server with a different DNS. Also in the Kali Linux zit de DNS chef function. I thought I already started it. Let's see. Yeah, it's already running. It's a simple command line tool. Let's see if I can go back to the start. Okay, let's see. So you can give a list. It's just really just a proof of concept there, what I want to show you. Here you see the DNS chef, it's just a tool. Start on the IP address of the Kali Linux. I said the true domain is nu.nl, and all other domains, you can say true domain or fake domain. I give there's one true domain. If I do nu.nl, it will resolve with nu.nl, and all other domains go to the fake IP, and I get another DNS on my system, and I can resolve whatever I want. Rabobank.nl go to www.appmanage.com. I think everybody get that, and it's also not really difficult to do that. And then the next part is okay. Then I can go and I can, for example, use a 0-day or all kind of other things. So we used a 0-day. Last 0-day, which was really in the news, was the Blue Keep. So if you're not updated, you can log in on a remote system and you get system administrator. I use something a little bit older, but that doesn't matter. It's about the proof of concept. So what I have here is a Windows server, an old server, unpatched, of course, but it's about the proof of concept. So I disabled all uploading logging to the Microsoft Defender ATP. And nobody sees it, you get no statements about it, because it sees, oh, you're offline. And then you can, for example, do without touching the box, without touching it's something, you can remote do an exploit, like the Blue Keep from 2-3 months ago. And now I do the Eternal Blue, which was from the NSA. Sometimes it got the blue screen, sometimes not. Let's try what is happening here. Then also the next reboot, it will work. So I set up Kali Linux. I use the exploit Windows SMB 17.0.10. Eternal Blue. I think everybody knows about the NSA tools, the Fuzzy Bunch. This is what I'm using. I set up that server. Now let's see if it works. Or we get the blue screen. So it's talking to the server, and it's trying to implement on the SMB. No, it's the blue screen version. It'll reboot, and then the next time it will work. And then we get system access to the system. There's also a problem. You cannot call the maker of the malware to fix this kind of issues. I can also always scroll back, because I tested it already. Then let's see, oh, here I was. They see them. If everything goes well, you get the win, and then you get the shell access, which I can show here. Let's see if I also can get it live. Here you can see where my I'm a system on that Windows server. So let's try it again. So that, and if it doesn't work, then you need so other exploits. But
if you have servers in your network which blue screen a lot, huh? Maybe Eric is in the neighborhood.
So this also was seeing why is this WannaCry as successful as that, because when I'm using it, I get many times a blue screen, so it could be worse, maybe the WannaCry thing.
Yeah, but you're actually exploiting a software vulnerability, so actually causing a blue screen to appear is actually quite obvious that it happens, because it's not supposed to do that. And we actually leverage it in the demo. Well, 10 minutes ago it was still working. And probably if we do it maybe two or three times again, it will probably work as well.
Last time, and otherwise you go further, I try it and then go back.
Three times should work, Eric.
Of course. But that's the idea. You get in the system. No, it get keeping no. Blue boxes. I will switch to the other machine, try to fix it.
Yeah.
To show it. But it's about the proof of concept, what we're thinking about, from okay, and that's the takeaway we want to give. Yeah, after implementing Microsoft Defender ATP. It's getting there.
1 second.
Yeah, I'll open it again. So what did we do? It's what I told. Although in the last part, we get a blue screen on the machine, which is also really cool, but not becoming admin. But if I try it again, it will work. But what we want to give or take to you after implementing Microsoft Defender ATP, you have to look at the incidents, you have to keep up to date with the secure score, and you have to fix also not only the Microsoft thing, but also your network. About to secure it, because if isn't a trusted network, you get other artifacts. You have to imagine about that.
Yeah, and we see more and more modern workplace devices actually joining non-secure networks, like the Starbucks, McDonald's, even the free Wi-Fi we have over here. So yeah, perhaps you could be a little bit cautious when doing so. On the other hand, we all use it. I use it as well, even though I'm aware. But we need to be careful with those kinds of networks. Oh, we see it now working.
Yes. So we move on. And so on if time the permits, bonus time.
Yeah, we will do that. So from our takeaways for today, is that not only implementing like a real advanced threat protection. It's not called advanced for nothing. Is not the only solution, it's part of a total solution. Keep software up to date, still be wary of links and attachments within emails. If you have like Office 365 ATP, who has it running? You actually see when you get an attachment, first the attachment is actually ATP scan in progress, and later then you actually get the real attachment. The attachment is being uploaded to Microsoft. Microsoft checks the attachment for malware, and then it's being released for you to use within your mail program. Watch out for malicious or compromised websites. How easy is it to redirect users to websites looking familiar, but not actually not being the website we are talking about? Don't install pirated material. That's maybe a no-brainer, but who didn't in the past? Don't attach unfamiliar removable drives. Same reason. So if you find a USB stick lying around, be careful and not put it in your machine, especially when you're an administrator. So even working as a non-administrator can actually solve that as well. So be careful with working with all the rights on your system. Microsoft also provides a lot of solutions for that. Of course, Microsoft updates are the main thing to actually implement. Use that, patch your systems regularly. Don't wait too long with patching your systems, even though you might have other reasons to do so. If you have a modern workplace, please make sure that you are updated within a month, if possible. We have controlled folder access. Somebody using that already? Where you can actually specify the folders where you can expect files to show up, and actually the folders which are not in that list are actually files are being blocked, or you can't do anything there. A reason to use Microsoft Edge is the smart screen technology. Any people using that? Which is using virtualization-based technology to isolate browser sessions. And people are actually swearing a lot about Edge, but it actually has good security measurements. And it will probably come into the Cratch, the new Edge based on Chromium as well. Exchange Online Protection, Safety Scanner, an offline tool which we can use. Also implement Office 365 ATP. You don't have to do it, but if you are licensed for it, please do so. Use OneDrive for Business, where, for example, if you have like some software encrypting all your files, you can actually go back in time because you have like a version history of all your files. And implement Windows Hello for Business on your devices as well, which has some challenges for which we can talk like for more than 1 hour as well. But that's maybe for another session. Eric, do you want to show the exploit?
Yeah, let's do that, like a bonus thing. But what I want to tell, so Microsoft Defender ATP is also a security product, but it's not 100% finished. Because if Microsoft has to implement DNSSEC and all that kind of extra security measures, it will be more a problem for a hacker to get get in the system. So I get a win, and now you see. Otherwise, I got also the blue screens. But now, who am I? Hostname. This is the hostname of the Windows server system. I can do anything on the system. ATP enabled, and nothing is uploaded to Microsoft, and I can also disable services if your system. What can you do? What you can do, and so you can also hack systems without having a kind of software on your machine. Yeah. So a remote exploit.
And to summarize, this is something you can find in like in YouTube videos. You can download Kali Linux, and even my son can do this kind of stuff. But what if he does that within a corporate network for some reason? So
this is an attack on the Microsoft system, but it can also be attack on a switch or a router, which is running for 5 years now, never software updated. So the Windows machines can update it, but if I have access to the router, there are also many exploits. It's not really a theoretical scenario. So that's what we want to tell you. Okay, not about the Microsoft marketing, Microsoft Defender ATP, I'm done. No, you have to look for a broader, and you have to catch up with the incidents. This morning, that incident was really happened. And nobody saw it because nobody looking at the incidents.
Yeah, so that's also one remark. If you have incidents, do something with them. Yeah. That concludes our session. So thanks. And maybe next time.
Yes.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.